Now I invite Dr. Jyoti Maya to present his talk on role of imaging in coronary angioplasty. He has completed his MBBS in MKCC Medical College, Berhampur, MD Internal Medicine is SCB Medical College, Cuttack, Odisha, DMP Cardiology at Apollo Hospital, Greens Road, and he is presently a senior consultant in interventional cardiology, MGM Healthcare, Chennai.
Good evening, everyone. I'm honored to be here. The second time I'm here in this prestigious podium. Why I choose this subject is it's like a lot of people do the coronary angioplasty, but what is the exact role of imaging that that changes the scenario of or the consequences of coronary angioplasty? How do we improve the results of coronary angioplasty is what we are doing. So this is the one cath lab what we have in MGM hospital, where this is a high-end Philips Julien model, which is a single plane model, which has this flat panel the screen, where everything is integrated. Like you can see you can do an IVUS, you can do all the imaging modalities can be integrated into one screen. So the operator should not be looking around for this place, that place. Everything can be integrated in one place. This is the one which I am doing at work. So basically, what are the imaging modalities we are talking about? So there are basically three imaging modalities which we come across. The most important thing is it is called an intravascular ultrasound. Second is the optical coherence tomography, which is called OCT. Third is the instantaneous free wave ratio, which is the newest mode of assessing the coronaries, and the time-tested fractional flow reserve. Now, what is FFR, what is IFR, why and how does it help it? Like, a fractional flow reserve is a very important tool for assessing the hemodynamics of a borderline stenosis. Like, we do an angiogram and then we see that there is a 50 to 70% drop. So what do? Do we have to put a stent? No. I mean, we don't have to put a stent on a 50 to 70% lesion. Because what we are looking at the coronary angiogram is a two-dimensional angio, which may not be, and it's an eyeballing. To you, it may look 50-60%, for me, it may look a 60% or 70%. So how do we have to prove scientifically that it is hemodynamically significant lesion or it is a hemodynamically insignificant lesion? This helps to decide whether this category of patient will require an angioplasty or the patient goes home without a stent. Now this uses a pressure wire which calculates the ratio between the pressure after the stenosis and the aortic pressure. Like, suppose there is a block in a left anterior descending artery. So we cross the wire, cross the lesion, and it takes the pressure beyond the lesion, beyond the stenosis and the aortic pressure. So it is PD by PE. Now if the value is significant, say it is less than 0.8, then definitely the patient goes for an angioplasty. But what if the patient is not having significant lesion? Suppose it says less than 0.8. I mean, it's more than 0.8, sorry. Then what we do is, we give an intravenous adenosine at 140 to 180 microgram infusion over 3 minutes and assess the FFR. Now, depending on the value, we decide whether the patient needs a PTC or a medical management. Suppose you have done an angiogram and then see on the table that it's like 50-60%. So the advantage of doing an FFR is you don't have to send the patient back home and again call him back and do a second procedure and then do an angioplasty, or send the patient back home telling that no, the FFR is negative. So we integrate the same FFR wire near the cath lab, where we see a coronary angiogram, see it is a 70% lesion. So and patient says, I'm not symptomatic. So in that case, and there is a definite change in the ECG and echo. So in that case, to know whether he is hemodynamically compromised or he is not hemodynamically compromised, we do the FFR on the same table so that if it is a 50-60% lesion and if the FFR looks still significant, then probably that is the patient we need to deal with the plasty. If the patient has a insignificant lesion, despite it looks 80% or say 75%, we don't have to stent that patient. Now, what is the instantaneous pre-wave ratio? It's a very latest and very new way. It is similar to that FFR wire, but the only difference is it doesn't require an adenosine infusion. When a patient is having a COPD, when a patient is having a bronchial asthma, and when you are doing an angioplasty with a very low blood pressure, say 90/60, or the patient is on a little bit of inotropic support, generally we won't be able to give adenosine in that artery. So what we do is, we do something called as instantaneous pre-wave ratio, or called IFR, which is integrated in only one machine that is called a Volcano machine, which is there in our hospital. And that Volcano machine is only integrated with this wire. And the greatest advantage is it is more faster, more accurate. And as compared to an FFR, when we are giving each and every coronary artery, we are giving 140 to 180 microgram of adenosine. Here, we don't have to give that adenosine at all. We just have to pass the wire in. Suppose we have a two vessel disease. We have to pass the wire in LAD, we have to pass the wire in circumflex. See the IFR value. If it is significant, then well and good. If it is not significant, just come out, send the patient home back home. Now, this is a very important aspect of imaging because this actually improves the quality of work which you are doing. Suppose, see, to put a stent is not a big deal. Anyone you train in them, they can go and do a balloon dilatation, put a stent and come out. But that is angioplasty, that is not angioplasty. So basically, you should put a stent, not just for the purpose of putting a stent. It should be done in a proper way. It should be done in a more scientific way, which generally requires an imaging and which will help the outcome. I mean, the morbidity and mortality decreases definitely with this imaging modality. Now, the principle of IVUS is based on the oscillatory movement of a piezoelectric transducer in order to produce some sound wave. It's basically a sound wave. It's just like an ultrasound. So a camera will be fixed to the catheter tip. It goes inside and it gives a direct images of the blocks and the characteristics of the plaques inside. So it gives us the information about the exact size and length of the stents to be used. And also, when you are doing a post-stenting, like when you have put a stent across already, we should know that whether the stent has opened nicely, whether the stent is opposing to the wall or not. Otherwise, the patient will again come back to you for with a stent closure. And it is a very important tool when we are dealing with something called a chronic total occlusion. Chronic total occlusion, the meaning is when the artery is 100% blocked for more than 3 months. Now, what happens is when we are going to open a 100% block and we don't know where exactly we have to poke the wire. So in that case, when the camera is just at the bang on the tip of the catheter, you can exactly locate where is the true lumen, where is the false lumen, and then you can negotiate the wire, which is possible nowadays with a lot of hardware which is available, thanks to the Japanese counterparts who give us constant the education in getting trained. And in case of left main stenting also, because left main is a very big vessel, and you should be very, 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 very careful when you are doing left main stenting. Of course, it was a domain of the surgical thing earlier days, but now the left main stenting is being done on a rampant basis. Now, this is the high-end IVUS machine which has integrated IFR, FFR. In one machine, we can do an IVUS, we can do an IFR, we can do an FFR, and all images can be integrated into one image. Now this is the photograph or the panel which generally is for my case which I had done. So you can see that the right and the left hand side, you can see the image, IVUS image, the fluoroscopy, the hemodynamics, everything you can see in a single panel. Now, how do we interpret an IVUS? When you are putting a camera inside, we should know the basics, we should know how do we interpret it. Now, as for the anatomy and the physiology and whatever, we see there are three levels where, you know, some intima, the media, the adventitia. Now, how do we differentiate this intima, media, and adventitia? The intima is actually a plaque, which is a dense and will appear white. And the media will appear as a dark. And adventitia is, you know, sheets of collagen that reflects a lot of ultrasound, which appears white. So it's like a white, black and white appearance. The calcific plaques, you see the amount of calcium, the previous speakers were talking about the calciums and all those things. You can see the calcium, how it is. And the first two pictures, it shows a mild calcification. But you see the third one, it is just like a circumscribed calcium. So when you are doing an angiogram, you don't know what exactly is there inside. So you see a 70-80% drop. And you see, you can't see this calcium inside. So what happens is, when you try to do an angioplasty in this kind of situation, you will literally land up in an unexpanded stent because you won't be able to break this calcium, it's a rock solid. So in this kind of situation, generally what we do is, if the anatomy is suitable, we do something called a rotablation. Rotablation means it is kind of a drilling machine which we use, but it is very sophisticated and then it should be done by very trained hands only. So, if at all, if we are not analyzing the inside lumen of the coronary and we try to put a stent here, then it is like putting a stent, a 3 millimeter size, into a 4 millimeter artery. What happens? There will be a difference gap. So, the stent and the lumen, there will be a lot of gap, and the patient comes back with again a heart attack or an instant restenosis. So it's a kind of a mixer plaque which shows a fibrous tissue, as well as you can see the dark part, the hypolucent area where this is the calcium, which is in the 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock position. Now in this kind of IVUS, we can actually characterize the type of plaque. Now there are stable plaques, there are vulnerable plaques. Vulnerable plaques are more prone for the acute coronary syndromes. So we should know exactly when we are doing an angioplasty, we are doing a tissue characterization, whether it is a fibrous plaque, whether it is a fibrofatic plaque, whether it is a high necrotic load, what is the amount of calcium in it. So everything can be seen by doing an IVUS, and not only the part which we are seeing. Suppose a mid-LED has a lesion, so our catheter goes down below to the LED and it takes the whole picture of the LED. So, in fact, we are not treating the lesion alone. We are treating the whole of the coronaries because we know what exactly we are going to do with this kind of a anatomy. Now, this is a very interesting slide. The arrow mark shows that this artery is an LAD artery, which is in one view. And you can see the second arrow, there is a small dent. That looks like it's a small, maybe a 20% drop. Somebody can say you don't need anything. But you can see the 9 o'clock till 3 to 12 o'clock, how it is, the hydrophatic plaque is encroaching the lumen. In the same thing, it is the same view. So what it looks, it is not there inside the coronaries. So, never believe your eyes. We can literally see the hematoma, whether it is an intravascular hematoma or whether it is an extravascular hematoma. It is inside the lumen. You can see that this is the arrow marks are the intravascular the hematoma. And this is the lumen and this is the extravascular hematoma. So, these are very, very important aspects when you are trying to do an angioplasty. You try to put a stent in this and then you land up in some disaster. So what are the diagnostic implications? So angiographically, maybe normal coronaries, and if there is any luminal irregularities by angiogram, ultrasound will usually demonstrate some disease at most other examined sites. And the coronary disease is usually disease, it is never focal. And that the coronary and angiography usually frequently underestimates the disease burden. In angiographically indeterminate lesion, indeterminate means from 50 to 70%, when we are not sure whether what to do with this patient, whether it's for medical management, whether the patient has anything to be done. So in ostial and bifurcation lesion, like in ostial lesion and bifurcation lesion, the stenosis may be obscured by overlapping the contrast rib structure. There will be some overlap where you don't know where what exactly I am going to do. In left main is the very important part of the coronary system. So aortic cusp opacification, so when you are trying to give the injection forcefully, the left main is so big that the dye may not be able to opacify the whole of the artery and it will give a streaming effect. So you may not be able to see the ostium of the lesion. So you will usually we miss the left main ostial disease unless otherwise you are you know what exactly you are going to do. And when the left main is very short, that time also you won't be able to differentiate, or you won't be able to know the exact anatomy. And the distal left main artery may be concealed by bifurcation or trifurcation. Sometimes the LAD and circumflex will be coming very close, so you won't be able to know what exactly is happening. Sometimes the ramus intermedius comes in between the LAD and the circumflex. So there also you will have a doubt, what should I do? So there the IVUS plays a very important role. In case of a transplant recipient, transplant coronary artery disease, where the disease is silent because the heart is developed and then the ischemia by functional testing does not usually occur until the disease is very advanced. And usually by 10 to 20% of patients at 1 year and 50% by 5 years, they do develop this disease. So the unstable plaque and thrombi also, the identification of the atheromas at high risk of rupture, and the acute coronary syndrome frequently develop in territories with minimally diseased vessels rather than high-grade stenosis. So pre-interventional imaging, we require the measurement of atheroma severity, plaque distribution, depth and extent of calcification. And post-intervention, like whether the stent is properly approved or not, approached or not, there is a malapposition, whether there is an edge dissection, there may be stent fracture, there may be plaque prolapse, there may be hematoma. So there is one more modality called OCT imaging, where we see the coronaries down to the artery from the coronary arteries. So it is an optimal optical, the same as that of the IVUS, but it uses a near infrared light. So I will show you some images where these are the way how this is the OCT looks like. This is the imaging catheter, and this is the guide wire, and this is the adventitial media intima. And you see the fibrous-rich plaque homogeneous, which looks so homogeneous. And you can see the calcium. It is very different from that of the IVUS. It is very a low Baxter with a low attenuation, sharp edges. And you can literally differentiate between a fibrous, between a lipid, and a calcium. So, I mean, it's a dark pixel, it's a diffuse, homogeneous. So all those things can be recognized by an OCT. And you can see what is a ruptured plaque like. You can see there is a discontinuation of the intima. You can see here. So these all things are very, very important for the patients to come back. Very young patient, 29-year-old. We saw one patient, 23-24-year-old, coming with a plaque rupture with an infravalvuline. And we did the angiogram, and then the thrombus, there was a plaque rupture. And then we again did the OCT, and then we had to stent it, because whatever said and done, we could not revive the actual lumen of the anatomy. So this again the vessel wall damage, and you can see a spontaneous dissection, so which cannot be seen by the coronaries, but you can see by the IVUS. And this is again a very important thing, new interval hyperplasia. After the stent, the you can see that this is the stent, which is small struts, and in between there is a growth of the structures. So the take-home message is imaging modalities like an FFR, IVUS, OCT are very, very important, not only for the tissue characterization, but also gives us the information regarding the need for whether you are going to put a stent or you are not going to. And the chance of morbidity and mortality reduces when we do an imaging guided PCI. It's a bit expensive, but it reduces the chance of the repeat PCI due to stent closure. Thank you so much. There is one more vessel, suppose a two vessel disease, say. An RCA, which is period is the mid RCA is diseased, and mid LAD is diseased. There is one branch which is coming up, that is a diagonal is diseased. Then, with a lot of comorbidities, a patient is chronically diabetic, because it's a smoker, then yes, patient goes for a CABG. If it is anatomically suitable, then definitely, yes, patient, we do an angioplasty. But definitely, yes. There are some places like if it's a heavily calcified lesion, tortuous lesion where we are not able to do anything for them. And the outcome of angioplasty may not be good. In that case, definitely, yes, patient has to go for a CABG. And I had a patient recently where he was a marathon runner. He is only, this thing is, he is a hypertensive. He came with an interval MI. And I did an angioplasty because it's 100% block, completely flush occlusion from this thing. And to my surprise, I saw all the three arteries were affected. So we have already done an angioplasty. So I can't send that patient for a bypass. So in that case, what we did was we kept him under medical management for 3 to 6 months. And then we staged the RCA and we left the circumflex without on medical management. So that is one odd cases where you know you get a triple vessel disease, but you have to do an angioplasty. But otherwise, if it's a triple vessel disease, generally patient goes for a bypass. Yeah. We do the calcium scoring and all those things, and then we decide how to go about it. And then if the calcification is high, if the disease is, if the artery is not that suitable for an intervention, then yes, patient goes for a bypass.
One of my relatives is a doctor who had a three vessel block. He's a very healthy individual. Everything in a non-smoker, non-alcoholic, nothing. He had a three-vessel block, suddenly he was detected. A stent was placed, 3SL. He was all right, discharged. Next day he had a heart attack and died.
That's what I told, that if you are not doing in a proper, the dictum is, the dictum in angioplasty is, you should treat the lesion, or you should respect that lesion. So you should pre-dilate that lesion properly, so that the plaques, whatever it has to be pasted into the wall, do a proper stenting. You should choose the proper size of the stent. See, suppose a 3 mm stent, eyeballing you do, you put a 2.5 because you don't have the this thing. Some people you know like okay fine, 2.5 should be okay. It is not that. 3 mm size should take 3 mm. Otherwise, you put a 2.75 mm stent, take a 3 mm balloon, expand it so that it gets properly incorporated into the wall. So if you have done a angioplasty with a proper pre-dilatation, post-dilatation, I don't think there should be a problem. But if you have done just a pre-dilatation with a half-hearted post-dilatation, I think you will get another job. And plus, if you are, suppose a patient who is having a, say, aspirin resistance and all those things, nowadays corticosteroid resistance and all those things, so in case if you have not loaded the patient properly, or the patient, so in those cases also, you may get an immediate stent thrombosis.
So in this case, say, due to stent thrombosis,
maybe it may be the case with stent thrombosis, because patient will not die without a stent thrombosis, because stent thrombosis, you have to open the artery, there is no other way. You have to either lyse the patient or maybe stent, because patient will come with an MI. So either you have to lyse it or maybe you have to just go, don't do a stenting again. Maybe we can put an aspiration catheter, suck it out and give some GP23 inhibitor for 48 hours and a fresh.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I request Dr. Muthu Perumal to present a certificate of appreciation.